Here's how we interpret the results of a SIBO breath test. My name is Bella and I'm a functional nutritionist and founder of the Functional Gut Health Clinic, where we help clients with SIBO and other digestive conditions take back control of their gut health. In this next video of our SIBO series, we're going to walk through how to read a SIBO breath test result, what makes a positive SIBO result, and some advanced interpretation tricks using hidden clues in the data. Let's start by understanding the information listed on a typical SIBO breath test report. Your report will likely have both a graph and a table with information for you to review, like this one pictured from SIBO test. The graph is a visual representation of the information in the table. So let's chat through the table first. Your SIBO breath test report starts with a column that lists the sample numbers. Next is the sample time intervals, starting with a baseline reading. They're listing samples every 20 minutes on this report. So most labs take samples every 15 to 20 minutes over about a 2 to 3 hour period. And these intervals help us track how gas levels in your breath change over time after consuming the sugar substrate. The next two columns on the SIBO report list gas levels for hydrogen and then methane gas, and they tell us if you have an elevation that indicates a positive SIBO breath test result. The baseline level, which is on the top row of the table, represents the initial levels of hydrogen and methane on your breath before you ingest the sugar solution. Remember, the sugar solution options are either lactulose, glucose, or fructose. And these baseline levels give us a starting point to measure gas level changes over time. The final column is the percentage of carbon dioxide in your breath sample, and it's used as a measure of whether the sample is valid and was collected in the right way. The number's normally between 3 to 4%, and if the level's below 1.5 or over 5.5, the sample ideally shouldn't be used. Let's focus back in on the hydrogen and methane columns. They report the levels of hydrogen, methane, and in some tests, hydrogen sulfide gas in ppm. So ppm stands for parts per million, which is a way to measure the concentration of gases in your breath. It's an important measure because it quantifies how much hydrogen or methane gas is being produced by bacteria or archaea in your gut. And the higher the number, the more gas those bacteria and archaea are producing. In addition to the table, most SIBO breath test reports include a graph that plots gas levels against time. On the horizontal x-axis, you have the time intervals, and on the vertical y-axis, you have the concentration of gases in parts per million. The time intervals are either expressed as the test tube number, starting from 1 as the baseline, the actual time of day each sample was taken, or in time increments, such as 20 minutes, 40 minutes, 60 minutes, etc. But what do these lines actually mean? And how do you know if you have a positive SIBO test result? We base our SIBO lab test interpretation off the North American consensus guidelines. The alternative is the European consensus, which is different and a little more conservative, as they aim to decrease the amount of false positive results. We also consider a client's health history, symptoms, and their lab results together, just to be really thorough. The North American consensus guidelines report a positive SIBO breath test as: hydrogen positive is a 20 parts per million rise from baseline within 90 minutes. Methane positive is 10 parts per million at any point during testing, including baseline. And hydrogen sulfide is not actually addressed in the North American consensus. After working with thousands of SIBO clients, we have made a few adaptations to simplify interpretation and reflect what we see clinically. So let me work through what we actually use when interpreting a client's SIBO test results. We consider a hydrogen positive result as gas levels of 20 parts per million or higher within 90 to 100 minutes, and up to 120 minutes for those who are constipated and likely have a slower transit time. The difference is we don't require a rise by 90 minutes. We consider methane positive as gas levels of 10 parts per million or higher at any point during the testing period, including the baseline. We may also consider methane positive when levels are between 3 to 9 parts per million for a client who has chronic constipation, but no other clues to explain their symptoms. Remember, symptom severity doesn't always correlate with gas levels, so low gas level clients can still have pretty severe symptoms. And finally, we consider a hydrogen sulfide positive test result as 3 parts per million or higher within 90 to 100 minutes on a lab that measures hydrogen sulfide gas, and up to 120 minutes for those who are constipated and likely have that slower transit time. We also use a flatline of both hydrogen and methane gas levels on a breath test where hydrogen sulfide gas isn't measured. We want to see hydrogen of 4 to 6 parts per million or below, and a methane of 3 parts per million or below for the whole 3-hour testing period to be considered a flatline. So the theory behind why we use a flatline of both hydrogen and methane gas as a clue for hydrogen sulfide SIBO is that hydrogen sulfide producing bacteria consume all of the hydrogen that's made by bacteria and used by archaea to make methane and convert it all to hydrogen sulfide gas so that the flatline is what we are left with on our report. Now let's look back at a lab test report and apply our guidelines to see whether we would consider this a positive or negative SIBO breath test result. As you look at the graph, you'll see a blue line representing hydrogen gas and a black line for methane gas. So normal baseline levels for hydrogen and methane in a fasted state are low. And then after ingesting the sugar solution, we typically expect to see a small rise in these gases as the solution travels through your digestive system, even when there's no SIBO present. However, a significant rise is a different story. For hydrogen, we're looking for a level of 20 parts per million or more within the first 90 to 100 minutes. And the idea here is that hydrogen-producing bacteria ferment the sugar solution rapidly as it passes through the small intestine. So anything from 90 to 100 minutes onwards can be considered large intestine time, depending on the transit time of the person taking the test. So this is why that 100 to 120 minute mark is referred to as the transition between small and large intestine, and also why we might consider an elevation during that time for a client who has slower motility and is very constipated as a positive SIBO result. This report shows hydrogen gas levels starting at 3 parts per million for baseline and rising to 23 parts per million by 80 minutes. So, this lab is positive for hydrogen SIBO using our criteria. For methane, a result of 10 parts per million or more at any point is indicative of SIBO. So methane producing archaea slow down intestinal transit time, which we need to take into account when looking at a client's lab results. This report shows a baseline methane of 18 parts per million, and it stays around this level for the full 3-hour testing period. This is considered positive for methane SIBO or intestinal methanogen overgrowth. For hydrogen sulfide, outside of the Triosmart test, which specifically measures hydrogen sulfide gas, we are looking for a flat line in both hydrogen and methane gas levels. This means that neither hydrogen nor methane levels rise significantly, and that suggests the presence of hydrogen sulfide producing bacteria. While a flat line can hint at hydrogen sulfide SIBO, it's not conclusive without specific testing for hydrogen sulfide. If we see a flat line and it correlates with typical hydrogen sulfide symptoms, then it's definitely something that we'll consider digging into. As you can see on this lab, both hydrogen and methane show elevations and levels above 4 to 6 parts per million for hydrogen and 3 parts per million for methane. So this is not considered positive for hydrogen sulfide SIBO. Now let's look at a couple of example labs that show positive results for SIBO. First is hydrogen dominant SIBO. So this client has a rapid rise in hydrogen levels exceeding 20 parts per million within the first 40 minutes. This is a really classic SIBO result and suggests an overgrowth of hydrogen producing bacteria are fermenting the sugar substrate really quickly as it travels through the small intestine. These high levels typically correlate with symptoms like bloating and diarrhea, which was true for this client. Second is methane SIBO or intestinal methanogen overgrowth. A baseline methane level of 10 parts per million or higher is a strong indicator of methane dominant SIBO or EMO. And a high baseline suggests a significant presence of methane producing archaea. You can see that this client has a methane level of 33 from baseline, and it rises above the limits of the lab, which is 81 parts per million from 60 minutes onwards. This pattern is often associated with constipation, bloating, gas, and slower intestinal transit time. Next up, we're going to look over two different labs that indicate hydrogen sulfide SIBO. So first up, we have a lab that doesn't measure hydrogen sulfide gas, but shows a flat line in both methane and hydrogen. You can see the parts per million reading doesn't get higher than 3 in both columns. This can be considered as a strong clue for hydrogen sulfide SIBO when correlated with a client's symptoms. If you want to be more confident, you can use the only lab currently available which measures hydrogen sulfide gas, the Triosmart breath test. In this lab, you can see that we have a positive hydrogen sulfide gas level above 3 parts per million. This lab shows a high baseline that stays high and around 10 parts per million throughout the whole testing period. So clients typically present with diarrhea, bloating, and gas, but not always. We have seen clients with elevated hydrogen sulfide gas levels on SIBO breath testing who are constipated, which was actually the case for this client. Next, let's take a look at what improper test prep looks like. Sometimes we get labs back that look like this, and you can see that hydrogen is very elevated from baseline at 32 parts per million, and then it drops quickly and doesn't elevate again in the small intestine. This is common when the test prep process hasn't been followed correctly. It was actually really hard to find a lab with improper test prep because our clients are just so good at it. This lab was from 2020 from a client that came to us with testing that they had completed themselves. And finally, it's helpful to see what a negative SIBO breath test result looks like. This is what we're aiming for after we've completed interventions and addressed SIBO root causes. This client came with a very elevated hydrogen and methane levels, so this is a lot of great work to bring down both gases. You can see that hydrogen is below 20 and methane is below 10 within the first 80 to 100 minutes. Overall, this just shows hard work come to life for a now very symptom-free client. The interpretation of SIBO breath test results has changed quite a bit over the last 10 years, and it's still changing with research and better clinical understanding of what correlates with symptoms for our clients. Having reviewed thousands of SIBO labs, we've developed our own sense of what actually matters for clients when we interpret their SIBO labs. This helps guide us with correlating results to symptoms and deciding when addressing SIBO makes a difference and when to look elsewhere for other potential root causes for symptoms. It's not always SIBO, and sometimes all a breath test is doing is pointing us in another direction. Here are a few of the more common test interpretation mistakes we see from those who don't specialize in SIBO. The first one is ignoring baseline levels of hydrogen. So we're looking for gas levels of 20 parts per million or higher for a positive SIBO-H test result, but we don't want this to be from baseline. If done correctly, the lowest value for hydrogen should be the baseline. We're looking for baseline hydrogen gas levels to be less than 10 to 15 parts per million, so we know that the test prep was completed correctly. If the baseline number is higher than this, then it's likely that the body is still fermenting carbohydrates from food that was eaten the night before or on the morning of testing, or something else has happened in the morning before the client has started the test. Again, in our clinical experience, we don't require a rise of 20 parts per million over baseline, but a rise from a very low baseline correlated with symptoms really strengthens our resolve that SIBO is an issue for the client. The second mistake we commonly see is misinterpreting the timing of peaks in gas levels and thinking that a rise in gas happens in the small intestine when it may actually be in the large intestine where a rise of gas is normal. In the early years of SIBO testing, we used to look for a classic double peak, one peak of gas in the small intestine around 90 minutes, then a dip through the ileocecal valve transition, and a second peak in gas in the large intestine. While peaks in gas levels are less of a focus these days because we don't always see them, it does help us to understand how the sugar solution travels through the intestines and where the bacteria or archaea are potentially in large numbers. Once you get past that 120-minute mark for hydrogen, you're really looking at the large intestine, where an elevation doesn't indicate SIBO. Elevations in hydrogen gas during the large intestine time are very normal and to be expected because we have high levels of good gut bacteria in this environment. Most breath test results these days include the testing criteria and an interpretation which makes the mistake of confusing large intestine time with small intestine time way less common. The next common mistake we see is focusing exclusively on SIBO as the root cause of symptoms in borderline SIBO cases. What I mean is, if a client has reported significant symptoms that match a SIBO profile and they only have borderline test results, what we typically find is that there's something else going on that's contributing to these symptoms, and SIBO is more of a secondary imbalance that we might address later on if it's still needed. The SIBO cases we see in our clinic that we're really focusing on are significant elevations that aren't anywhere near borderline numbers. We've had hydrogen and methane elevations for clients literally go off the charts, like well above 100 parts per million for some clients. So numbers in the low 20s for clients who are very symptomatic tell us that we might need to look elsewhere for clues to help them. The fourth mistake is overlooking flatline patterns and not considering hydrogen sulfide SIBO where the symptom profile matches. Low hydrogen and methane throughout the entire test may be due to an overgrowth of hydrogen sulfide producing bacteria, which consume both gases and produce hydrogen sulfide gas. So a flatline is something that we'll still use for clients who have symptoms to match, but it's very helpful to have the Triosmart SIBO breath test that includes the third gas, hydrogen sulfide, so that we can be more confident we're on the right track. And the final mistake we commonly see is thinking that you only need to address the type of gas elevation that's shown on your first SIBO test report. Remember, we can't actually see what's happening in the small intestine, and we're using gas levels as our guide for helping clients get rid of symptoms. What can happen for some clients is that they have multiple types of SIBO, but only one will show up on testing because of gas dynamics and how gases are consumed by different organisms. The most common scenario we see is methane showing as elevated on initial testing, then showing as low on retesting, while hydrogen has now elevated. In addressing one type of SIBO, another type that was previously at a low level will see the opportunity to overgrow now that its main competitor has been eradicated or reduced in number, but motility still hasn't been restored in the small intestine. So try not to be discouraged if you find another gas is elevated on retesting, especially if this gas correlates with your symptoms. This is very common and something that we see almost weekly. Now that you understand how to interpret a SIBO breath test lab report, in the next video, we'll discuss our detailed approach to addressing SIBO.